Hello friends, in this video we are going to look at semaphore and mutex, which are used for process synchronization. So we already had a look at spin lock, many of the spin lock solutions, and we already saw that Pearson solution has a problem on running on multiple processors. So I've already discussed the issue with Pearson solution in a separate video. Attach that link in the video. Other solutions were test and set. So these are the hardware solutions, test and set, and swap instruction, hardware instructions. So I already made my last two videos on these two instructions, test and swap, test and set and swap, and I discussed how we can use this hardware instruction to solve the critical section problem. And we are calling this all solution as spin lock, because when a process is already in the critical section, then the other process, what they do is you have a while loop, right? So they keep on waiting in this while loop and wasting the time of the CPU, because CPU does not do any productive work by executing this while loop. And these two solutions, semaphore and mutex, so these solutions are different from spin lock. We will see how they are different. But before going into the actual code of semaphore and mutex and how they are able to solve the critical section problem, I will explain these three, spin lock, semaphore and mutex, with an example of a room and a key. Or you can assume that room is a toilet also, or it just is a simple room, any room. So you have a room here, and you will have lock also here. There is a box here in which the key of this room is, key of this room is present. Now multiple persons want to access this room. So let's say the first person arrives in sequence. Let's say taking the case here when you have collision, like first and second arrive at the same time. That can also happen, but I'm not taking that example here, just for making this example simple, right? Now first person, when he or she arrives, they will check the box, and they will he or she will find the key, and he or she can take the key from here, open the lock and go inside. Now the first person is inside the room. Now when the second person comes, so I'm talking about the spin lock case here. So when the second person comes, what he or she will do is they will keep waiting here. Or what they can do is they can just spin around this box. I'm just taking the example. So they have to wait here. That is my point. So third person also has to do the same. He or she also has to wait here for the key. Now when the first person, he or she exits from this room, now they will place the key here again. Sorry for making this very dirty. So key will be present here again, first person put it. Now second or third person, any one of them, will again check for the key and find it. So whoever finds, let's say first, will take the key and go to the room. So this will keep on happening. Again, when fourth person comes, he or she will again wait here, and when the key is available, then they can take and enter the room. So this is a spin lock, where these persons are waiting here, right? So this is a spin lock. Okay, let's go to another page. So this has become dirty. I'll explain the concept of mutex and semaphores. So again, you have room here, lock here, again the key here. Again, I'm now explaining about the mutex. Again, you have multiple persons coming here, right? And they will do the same. First person will come, he or she will take the key from here, go inside the room. So this is similar. Now first person is not here, he has gone inside the room, but second person won't find the key. But the second person, unlike the case of spin lock, they will not keep waiting here. So what they will do is, you will also have, let's say, series of beds here near this room, or beds. Now what a second person will do is, he or she will just go and sleep on this bed. A third person will go to this bed and sleep. Similarly, fourth will sleep here, five will sleep here. Now when the first person exits from here, he or she will place the key again here first, and then after placing the key here, he or she will go to this queue of bed and wake up the first person from here. So that is second person. Now second person will again go and find the key and enter this. Similarly, when second exits, he or she will, wake up this person. This will keep on going. So this is mutex here. Oh, mutex and semaphore are, I mean, to be fair, I mean, mutex is a kind of semaphore. Okay, we'll discuss about that later. But in semaphore, what happens? Instead of one room, you will have multiple rooms. First room, again another room, multiple rooms. And also, you will have multiple similar keys and similar locks will be here. So, you will have three similar keys, let's say key, and key, right? Now, when the first person arrives, he or she will take any of this key, let's say this key, and will enter the first room. Second person will take this key and enter the second room. And third person will take the last key and enter this last room. Now all the rooms are full. Now when the fourth person comes, let's say fifth, sixth, any seventh, right? The fourth person will see that there are no key here in this. So this is also a box. Now fourth person will see that there are no keys available here. So fourth will again, like the mutex, same thing it will do. It will go here and sleep here. Fourth person will sleep here. Similarly, fifth will sleep here, sixth will sleep here, seven will sleep here, right? Now, when let's say any one of them, one, two, or three, when they exit from this room, what they will do is they will place the key here again. So let's say first exits, he or she will place the key here and wake up the first, I mean any one of them from here. Now again, four can go and take the key and enter the room. Similarly, second person, second also, third also, they will also do the same. So this will go on. So all the difference between mutex and semaphore, if you see here, is that in the case of mutex, you only had one room, and in case of semaphore, you had multiple rooms. And okay, and this example, this okay, I will explain this in the terms of, I mean, operating system. So this persons here, right? These are the multiple threads that you have in the operating system. And these rooms are the critical section. So there is actually one critical section. So you should not be confused that there are multiple critical sections here. There is only one critical section, but you are allowing. So these are similar code, right? All the three are similar, but you are just allowing multiple threads to enter the critical section at a time. So you are allowing three threads to enter the critical section at a time. Then also you have key. So these key are similar to your locks, right? So any thread has to obtain this key before entering this critical section, right? So this is the concept here. Now we will actually, I think you would have understood about the spin lock and mutex and semaphore from this example. And now we will look at the how mutex and semaphore is actually implemented and also how they are able to solve the critical section problem. Let's now look into the implementation of the semaphore. So mutex is also a semaphore. So first we will look into the semaphores, then at mutex. So this is the definition for a semaphore. S any semaphore, it consists of value and a list, process list. So this process list will be a list of process control block. I'll explain why this list is needed. So this value is the I mean, for example, lock, you have value, right? False or true. So here you will have integer value. I mean, this value can be any positive number to begin with. And so normally what this value signifies is, if the value is 3, that simply means that you have 3 rooms. I mean, from the above example, or in sense of critical section, 3 threads at max can be in the critical section at the same time. That's what this value means. And now we will follow this structure of, I mean, process synchronization. So you will have, so this is the wait will, this is the entry section here. So this wait will again relate with this code, but we will denote it wait as. Then you will have critical section, and then you will have exit section in form of signal. So I've written the code of signal down here because I didn't have a space. I'll explain that later. So this is a structure now we'll follow. So first look into the wait. So these suppose two operations, semaphore, wait and signal. First let's look into the wait. We will see this with an example, that will be better. So, and also remember that wait is also sometimes called as somewhere you will see that P operation, I mean, they will call it P operation, or sometimes they will call it as down operation because it's subtracting, right? So they will call it down operation or P operation. So all are same, weight, P, down, everything is same. Now, let's take example of, okay, you have value equal to 3, and you have, let's say, first process, second process, third, four, five in sequence. They are coming in sequence, first, second, these are the process name, right? So when the first process comes, right, what it will do is it will decrement this value of 3. So it will make it 2, right? From 3 to 2. Now it will check if the value is lesser than 0. Then, but the value is 2, that is not lesser than 0, right? So nothing will happen and it can then enter the critical section. Then after 1, the second process will come, right? So it will again decrement the value to 1. And it will again check lesser than 0, no. So it can also enter the critical section. So it will also get the room. Now when third comes, third will also decrement this to 0. As well, lesser than 0, no. It's equal to 0 but not lesser than 0. So this third also will get another room, right? Now when the fourth, the fourth process comes, it will set the value of S value minus minus. So it will become minus 1, right? Now minus 1 is lesser than 0. So what we'll do is, you remember in the case of semaphore, I told that we will make that person sleep, right? So similar in the case of process, we will add this to a separate list. So that's why list is here. So this is a list maintained. So we had beds there, right? So similarly, we have list here where we will append this process. Which has to wait. So we will now, so this fourth person will wait, right? So this is the, let's say, the list pointer here, right? So now the fourth is waiting, right? And also remember this important function block, right? So in case of spin lock, right, the process used to spin in that while loop. Here what we are doing is blocking the process. So blocking the process means removing the process from that CPU, and the state of this process will be now changed from the running to waiting state actually. So this process will be removed from the CPU, and some other process now can occupy the CPU. So that's one benefit of this. And okay, now fourth is also cut and it's there in the queue. Now fifth will also come, and it will decrement the value to minus 2, right? And this will also again, as well lesser than 0, it will be again added to this list and removed from the CPU again. Now what will happen, let's say the now 1, 2, 3, right, they are already in the critical section. Now they also want to exit at some time, right? So after this, now you will have signal operation. Okay, I'll keep it here. Clarity, okay. Yeah. So now you will have signal operation. So now first, which process will? So the let's say the first process exits first. So I am taking this example for simplification, order for simplification. Now, first process, what it will do is it will increment the value. So now the value was minus two, right? So it will increase the value from minus two to again minus one, right? Now it will check if as well less than equal to zero, right? Yeah, it's negative, right? Less than equal to zero. So now what you will do is remove a process from. Sorry, okay, I will again write that. So you had process. Sorry, list was there, right? And then you had 4 and 5 here, right? So you remove a process from this list. So let's say we remove 4 from this, right? So we remove 4 from this and wake up P. So as you remember, we had blocked the process, right? This process was blocked. Blocked means these are removed from the CPU. So what happens when you call wake up process P? So this process, it does not mean that this process will again enter into the critical section or something like that. It just means that it will again go into the ready state. If you remember the event states of the process, ready is, so there is a ready queue. So this is not running state, this is ready state. Now now process scheduler can, I mean, depending on the algorithm, it can again schedule this process and then it can enter the critical section. So that's what I used to remember. And okay, now four was removed and it got the right. Now after that, what happened? Now second process was also inside the critical section. This also one, I mean, exit. This also exits the critical section. So it will also come onto a signal code and S value plus plus. From minus, it was a minus 1, right? Now it will become 0. And now if S value less than equal to 0, yeah, it's equal to 0. Remove another process from the S list. Now only 5 is there, remove this from the list. Now this will be null. And wake up P. Similarly, make the state of, so you are in waiting state, make the state to ready. And then the scheduler can schedule this at any other time. So that's what this logic is. And if you see here equal to 0, right? Why it is equal to 0, not less than 0? Because if you see the code here, right? So minus one actually meant that one process was waiting, right? But you incremented the value here, right? So because one process was leaving. That does not mean that still you have one process waiting, right? So still you should go, right? But the value is 0. The value has been made 0 because one process also exited from the critical section. But the number of process waiting is still same, right? It is still 1. I mean, the value is minus 1. That means the waiting process was 1. So that's why you should again go into this code. So that's the code for this. Now we'll look into how this satisfies. Okay, one more important thing is, okay, I forgot to discuss it. Okay, this whole code, right, this should be again run as one indivisible code. Atomically. Let's take the issue what happens when this does not run atomically. So what can happen, you see this, I'm just giving you one of the issue what can happen. There are many other issues can happen. This S value minus minus and this S value plus plus, right? If they are incrementing at the same time, race condition can happen. I already have given this example, similar type of example in the race condition video. So that's why this both the function should be executed atomically. Now, how will you execute this function atomically, right? So I mean, just for solving this critical section problem, again, you have to solve another critical section problem, right? So this, there is a critical section problem within a critical section problem. So again, you have to, use the test and set or the swap hardware instruction to, avoid the race condition in this wait and signal operation. So what you can do is, before a process, tries to execute this wait, it has to obtain the, let's say, test and set lock. And the similar case will be for signal also. Here we will have test and set. So again, you will have entry section here, exit section here, right? So you can see the test and set code which I have described in my previous video. So critical section, two critical section you will have here. So this is one critical section again. Another critical section is this. So you are protecting this with the help of the semaphore. And we are protecting this with the help of, the spin lock or the test and set or swap. So, if you see here, right, you are using spin lock also as well as semaphore also. Okay, now I didn't explain mutex. So mutex is very simple. So if the value of this value, right, is 1, then that semaphore is called mutex. So mutex is a kind of semaphore with the value of semaphore as 1. And it's named mutex because when the value is 1, it can be used for mutual exclusion, right? So when you have the value 1, right, so once it becomes 0, no process can enter, right? Second process will make it minus 1, it cannot enter, it has to wait. And when the value is 1, then some process can enter, right? So it's like a mutual, it's normally used for mutual exclusion, and that's why it's named mutex. But now you'll think that what are the uses of this, why we have three things, right? Spin lock, mutex and semaphore. It's not that you will think initially that spin lock is bad, right? It's not so, spin lock is bad that it just wastes CPU, but it's not actually that bad. There is always trade-off between mutex, spin lock and semaphore. So we will look about this in a separate video actually, but one use case of spin lock you saw here, right? In this case of semaphores, you have to, even in semaphore you have to use the test and set a swap to protect this critical section of code, right? We will look into like where to use what, where, I mean, in which condition to use spin lock and which condition to use mutex, and in which condition to use semaphore in another video. So I hope that you would have understood how this works. And if you remember that example of the room and, I mean, the key, it will be very useful actually in understanding this. And also you should remember about this condition, like why it is lesser than 0 here and equal to 0 here. So normally S value, if it is greater than 0, right, it signifies like some rooms are available. It is, if it is 4, that means like so many rooms are available, right? If it is equal to 0 means, I mean, there are no rooms available, and I mean all the rooms are basically busy, and there is also no, I mean, process waiting. If it is lesser than 0, that means, I mean, the magnitude of this, if it is -1, that means one process is waiting, -2 means two processes waiting, -3 means three processes waiting. That's why it signifies. And only you should remember that when, in this case, why it is equal to 0 is, you should remember that, I mean, I told that, right, -3 means three processes are waiting. Now even if you increment the value of S value here from -3 to -2, that is still, now means that three processes are still waiting, right? So in case of -1, you saw, right, even if you made it to 0, right, so this is the corner case. So even if you made -1 to 0, but still -1 means, before means was that one process was waiting. Now you made it to 0, that still means that one, that process is still waiting, right? So that process will still be, I mean, woken up from the sleep, and it should be scheduled, right? So that's why this you should remember. So that's all for this video. In the next video I'm going to discuss about this spin lock mutex, what are the use cases of this, where to use what. Thank you.